What am I supposed to do?
I think the intro.
Oh. Hey, welcome back. It's the Joel Comm Show, and glad you guys are here. I missed you so much. It hurts deep, deep inside. Got a great show for you today. Entrepreneurette Jen Groover is with us. We've got a new top 10 list. We've got tips for making money online. We've got monkeys. I've got blank paper. It means a blank slate. I don't know what I'm going to do. Dan Nickerson is with me. Stay tuned. It's the Joel Comm Show. Welcome to the show. We've been gone for a while.
Long time.
And a little tear.
It's been tough. We've actually been getting work done.
But we're back. And we're back with a vengeance and taking the bar to the next level. Not the bar you were at last night. No. This is a different bar.
No, we're raising
the bar on production and really seeking to bring value to the online business community through some of the things we're going to be able to share with you about doing business online and having a little fun along the way. Got some great guests that have already been parading through the studio.
Big time.
A guest parade, and you're going to get to meet them over the coming weeks. But right now, we're going to do the featured tweet. You know, really enjoy Twitter. With the success of the book Twitter Power, a lot of people come to me and ask me how they can use Twitter for business, and we've actually set up a hashtag for the show. So anytime you tweet about the Joel Comm Show, simply use the pound sign and then my name, Joel Comm. Creative.
Very cool.
So, tweet of the week.
Yeah. So, we do iFart, iFart Mobile, the iPhone.
You did
app.
Know that, right?
You knew that, right?
Okay.
And so, I follow the iFart at iFart, and I saw this great tweet about iFart today. The guy said, "Another tip taken from Photo Pro Mag: have loaded iFart onto my iPhone for use when photographing children." Well, that's my excuse. So the guy basically uses it to get kids to laugh when he's taking pictures, and it helps with his pictures.
So. If I understand correctly, using iFart has helped increase his bottom line.
Absolutely.
His bottom line.
Yes,
see what I did there?
Absolutely, yes.
One of the most popular segments of the previous Joel Comm Live was Dan's top 10 lists. Viewers have been writing in. We get mail. I mean, stacks and stacks of mail. That's all
We actually print it?
Yeah, that's the junk mail.
Seems crazy.
But one person wrote in and said, would you continue the top 10 lists? And so here we go. This is the top 10 reasons that we've been off the air since May of 2009.
It has been May, right?
Was it May?
At least.
Chris the Hand Harper, our producer behind the cameras. So top 10 reasons we've been off the air since May. Number 10, it took 5 months for Joel's clone to mature. And I look amazingly like the real thing.
Too bad we couldn't fix the glasses thing.
New glasses. You like them?
Yeah, not bad.
They're bifocals. I'm getting old.
Nice.
Progressive. So if I do, I don't have to do this anymore.
Things are looking up.
Yeah. Number 9, Joel's teleprompter broke. Number 8, global warming caused icy buildup on the sets.
It's very cold summer.
Number 7, it was rainy.
Yes.
Number 7 in the top 10 reasons we've been off the air since May, Dan had his jaw wired shut due to a flying monkey mishap.
Yeah, what did that happen again?
And you've recovered.
Yeah, I didn't lose any weight, surprisingly.
Number 6, Chris the Hand Harper briefly escaped to Switzerland. Just a couple weeks.
Yeah.
But we got him back.
Yeah, we didn't think he was going to be back.
Ever.
Ever.
Number 5, Ustream couldn't handle our bandwidth. You can't handle the bandwidth. Boy, there's so many lines there would just be so inappropriate for the show. I'm not going to go there. Number 4, Kanye West said Beyonce wrote better top 10 lists than Dan.
True. Talked to Jay-Z last night about it.
Number 3, out of respect for Michael Jackson, did you hear?
No.
Number 2, Joel didn't want it to influence the Nobel Peace Prize voting. Did you see that site?
NobelPeacePrizeGenerator.com? Yes, I did.
This is a riot. Nobel Peace Prize Generator. Because, you know, Obama got the Nobel Peace Prize because of the work he was going to do.
Right.
Right? It's the intention.
Yes.
You know?
It's intentions, not actions.
I am actually going to dress up as Mother Teresa for Halloween and do good works.
Nice.
So where's my Nobel Peace Prize? And the number one reason that we have been off the air since May, the FTC said we had to inform viewers that most people would not find us funny.
Which is true.
Top 10 list, Dan Nickerson, the VP of Ideas. So a couple years ago, I was at a conference in LA, and one of the attendees was a sharp woman by the name of Jen Groover. Jen introduced me to one of her products that is now sold at stores all over the world, I think, called the Butler Bag, which my wife instantly fell in love with, and had the opportunity to get to know Jen a little bit and her entrepreneurial spirit, and invited her to be a guest on the Joel Comm Show. Here's what happened. Our guest today is a leading serial entrepreneur. It doesn't mean that she eats a lot of cereal, it just means she can't help but entrepreneur. She is a creativity and innovation guru, says Success Magazine. She's the creator of a butler bag. This woman has taken a dishwasher and turned it into a purse. I kid you not, wait till you see this. She's regularly a guest on many national media outlets. She has pioneered the business and lifestyle expert niche. In fact, I think she coined the phrase for it. She's the author of an upcoming book that you're going to want to read called What If and Why Not. She's got a site called launcherscafe.com, and she is a regular contributor to the Huffington Post. Her name is Jen Groover. Jen, welcome to the program.
Thank you for having me.
So glad for you to stop by here and chat with us for a little while.
I am so happy to be in Colorado today.
Yeah, the Rockies are beautiful,
aren't
they?
Yes, they are.
And we also have a baseball team called the Rockies.
Ironically,
and
so.
They...
And I might get a game in while I'm here.
And that would be great.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful park. And, of course, the park is open in one of the fields, so you can see the mountains over the
I would hope so,
stands.
Actually.
That's very cool.
I love baseball.
You are, you're an amazing woman. I mean, you are, like, always coming up with the next big thing and one of the greatest fans of getting out there and telling people to become entrepreneurs.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you think of this whole recession thing?
Well, I think it's an amazing time to become an entrepreneur because the big companies that used to be considered the competition are all scaling back right now. Mm-hmm. They're staying out of the way of doing anything innovative. They're scared to death. They're just hunkering down. They're eliminating people. And so now is the time to actually move in and make your mark. Also, everything's negotiable right now. Things are cheap. Labor's cheap. And I don't mean that in a way that's taking advantage of people, but you can actually negotiate with people who have great experience and great talents right now, where 3 years ago you couldn't. I remember hiring people coming out of college saying, I want this and I want that, and things that I never even thought of when I was coming out of college, but they could then. And
well,
now,
they want to work. People want to work.
People want to work. People have been laid off for 2 years now, some people, and that rehiring is not accelerating right now. It's very stagnant. So now's the time, because also you can negotiate with vendors. You can get your products cheaper. You can get quality for a better quality, because people are really focused on customer service right now. And so there's so many advantages. Plus, people are looking for innovation right now. People are looking for reasons to spend their money right now.
What do you think? Is the recession as bad as we hear it said in the mainstream media?
I think it's as bad as your perspective is.
Yeah.
And that's life in general and every aspect of it.
I don't like to watch a lot of news because I feel like it's a downer. There's bad news out there, but why do I want to fill my mind with it and be inundated with it when there's so many things to be hopeful for?
Right. Hope is the driving force. And if you are watching constant bad news coming at you and this is the worst recession since the Great Depression, then all of a sudden you're going to be in that same mode that those corporations are in, and you're going to be like a deer in headlights, and you're going to freeze. If you do not allow that to affect your positive perspective and what your passion and dream is, you can move forward. Now, yes, there are going to be hiccups, and you and I have talked about this before. Things change. My game plan has changed. I'm sure your game plan has changed, but I will look back.
Game plan.
The game plan.
Game plan. Do I have one here somewhere? I must
or
have
fly
left
by the seat
suit.
Of the pants,
yeah.
Which I am very much too. But, you know, I am going to look back and be grateful for this time period, because even now, just analyzing what I've come up with in the past 6 months, mm-hmm. I don't think I would have had I not been pushed into an uncomfortable space mm-hmm. of what the economy is. And so to say that everything's perfect is wrong, but also if you feed into that fear, then you will be part of that fear while everybody else is moving forward.
If it doesn't kill you,
makes you stronger.
And what I want to know
smarter
is,
too.
Who are they?
They is the wise people sharing their wisdom.
Is it like the Illuminati?
Someone writes it down.
they sit in a room, you know, somewhere in the top of the UN building, and they hand down these decisions, and we refer to them, and they say.
They say it. And I see it as more of like this vase that we open up the lid to, and the wisdom comes out.
Did you say vase?
Vase.
Really?
Or me.
Lovey, we're going to the ball right now. Don't forget to put the flowers in the vase.
The vase, the vase, tomato, tomato.
Yeah. Now, I mentioned in the introduction that you took a dishwasher and turned it into a purse, more than a purse. Explain that, because right now that sounds crazy.
Right.
Like, oh, does that mean it washes your stuff when, you know, your lipstick?
The moral of the story is inspiration is everywhere and opportunity is everywhere. You just have to have your eyes and heart open to it at all moments and be looking for it. So think of the Snuggie, too, right?
Mm-hmm.
Snuggie. Oh, someone put their bathrobe on backwards and thought, hey, wait, this could be something.
Right.
How many people would never thought that that could be something? But I was tired of digging through my handbag, looking for my cell phone, my keys, losing my credit card.
I was tired of looking through your handbag, too.
I know. Or Mary's dumping it out, looking for the keys.
Mm-hmm. It's in there. It's in the inside compartment. Which one? The zipper one. Which zipper? Oh, it's agonizing.
It's a bucket. I kept thinking, why are women accepting a bucket to dump our stuff in? And then we have to dump it out and panic looking for something. I don't know how many credit cards I canceled thinking I lost my credit card when really I was in there and just couldn't find it at that moment. So I planted that seed for myself that there had to be a better way. 6-7 months later, I was unloading my dishwasher and I was taking the silverware out of the silverware tray and everything was standing up straight and I had a bird's eye view and I thought to myself, wait a second, this is exactly how I want everything in my bag to stand up. So I have a bird's eye view of it, even that little tiny lip liner that you won't get rid of. So I literally took the dishwasher tray out of the dishwasher, stuck it in my bag, put all my stuff in, everything was standing up straight. And it was something so simple. People thought, oh, well, pockets have done and, you know, other way. It's been done in other ways, but the rigid compartments was the key to this so that everything would stand up straight. So it wasn't more pockets that you were digging in, like you just said, what's in the pocket within the pocket.
Right.
It's a bird's eye view of everything in your bag the second you unzip it.
And it's brilliant. I mean, I remember when I got one for my wife and she was like, this is so cool. And then she went to the website and said, oh, I want this one too.
Got a couple more.
Yeah, she wanted this one too.
The repeat customer.
So how much soap do you put in the purse to when you turn it? No, it's not how it works.
No. It's literally the butler bag because it's like having your personal butler with you.
And in the cell. I mean, you've been featured in Oprah's must-have list, right?
Yeah.
For the holidays.
And Ellen just featured it on her show as the must-have.
Wow.
On Ellen's Big Picks. And people, I mean, literally every fashion and lifestyle magazine since we launched, it's being tracked as one of the fastest-growing handbag brands in history. Had a licensing deal 18 months into the company, which is unheard of. And that then allows me to really catapult the brand into an entire lifestyle brand. So it's not just handbags now, it's accessories, it's belts, it's everything about fashion innovation, problem solution products, from fashion and accessories, now moving into household products too.
That's great. You are a brand. I mean, and this is one thing that you've done. You know, you're building websites, you've got your Launchers Cafe, you're trying to inspire other people to take the entrepreneurial route and equip them with what they need to make that happen. And the book, What If and Why Not? Tell me about that.
So my inspiration came because I would always have these ideas. Would always try and sell my idea to somebody. And in our culture, in our society, everyone is conditioned to tell you what's wrong with your idea, why it won't work.
Why do people do that?
I don't know. And my book actually opens up by saying football is the American pastime, but I'd actually have to say telling people why their ideas won't work, it seems like it's the real national pastime.
I know why.
Because we're afraid. I think people are fearful. I think people are jealous on some levels.
Right. Well, it's the schoolyard bully mentality, right? If I push you down, it makes me look taller.
Right.
And people are afraid to take risks on their own. Mm-hmm. And so they figure if they crush your dreams, then that somehow affirms in them that they don't have to pursue theirs.
Right. And it's unfortunate, too, because this is a country that was built on exactly that, entrepreneurism, dreams, ideas. So what I learned when I was sitting defending my ideas in these meetings, you know, for the Butler bag, for example, I'm sitting in a boardroom full of people who have been in the industry for 20-some years. Many of them were born into the industry, telling me why it wouldn't work, how it's been tried before, how it's failed. And I said, finally, what if it does? What if it works this time? And you had a chance to be a part of it, and you said no. Because we're conditioned to say no in that situation because we're afraid it's going to fail. But what if it succeeds? And so I realized at that moment, the power exchange at that table was instant. Instead of that person trying to defend their idea or defend why they thought my idea wasn't a good idea, they actually sat back and thought, what if I do say no? And what if she's right? Then I really look like an idiot. Then I'm really going to kick myself. And then I kept thinking about that. Wow, that really changed the tables. But then I realized further, the biggest what if is usually within ourselves. We usually have these ideas, and then we're all excited, we're passionate about it, but then we tell ourselves every reason why it won't work.
What if I fail?
What if I fail? What if I don't make money? What if? So the book, What If and Why Not, is really taking the reader on my personal journey through all of these different what if stories and experiences in life and teaching people how to reset their thoughts, most importantly. So instead of what if I fail, well, what if you succeed?
The inspirational words, What If and Why Not, the book available in bookstores everywhere shortly.
Yeah.
Your website, jengroover.com, and follow Jen on Twitter at Jen Groover. Jen, thanks so much for coming and visiting.
Thanks for having
Appreciate
me.
Appreciate it. It was great to have Jen here. She believes that our educational system fails by not teaching students, especially in college, how to be entrepreneurial.
Absolutely.
Right. Business courses, they teach the textbook stuff about economics and marketing, but do they really teach you how to go up, set up your own business, how to get clients, advertisers, how to really market?
Because the teachers wouldn't be teachers if they were entrepreneurs.
Oh, good point. But yeah. I have a great respect for teachers.
Yeah, me too.
They are, them and housewives, mothers, are the most underpaid people on the face of the earth. Score brownie points with my wife. So a lot of stuff been going on around the office.
Yeah, it's crazy. Crazy. We have had film crews in here. We've had lots of guests. We've had flying monkeys, Legos, all kinds of crazy stuff.
That's for another show. But the film crews, the folks from Jon Stewart's Daily Show was here.
Yeah, that was a big production.
It was the whole iFart success was very explosive.
Very explosive.
More puns.
Yes, more puns. I can't come up with puns like you can. Yes, I can, but I don't want to upstage
you. He's the VP of ideas, and this is what I get. Let's take a look at a clip from the broadcast of The Daily Show.
After tackling the energy crisis with my guest, Secretary Chu, it's time to look at also some daunting legal matters. The confirmation of Sonia Sotomayor to the Supreme Court's taken forever. But the cases that go before the court are really important. You can't be too careful. Wyatt Cenac takes a look at one case that will inevitably go supreme.
Business rivalries have always been cutthroat, from Coke versus Pepsi, to Ted Turner versus Rupert Murdoch, and now Eric Stratton versus Joel Comm.
We originally got the idea for iFart in the late summer of 2008.
With the power of his dominant application company, Infomedia, iFart quickly knocked Pull My Finger off the top of the charts.
iFart's a superior product because of the utility features that are built into the application, such as security fart, sneak attack, fart a friend. Secondly, we have more variety of sounds.
Yeah. You have a minute? Sure. What's up, Chris?
Have you noticed Joel acting kind of different lately?
Yeah, you're going to have to be more specific. You know, we are talking about Joel here. He's the man with 45 flying monkeys in his office.
Yeah, good point. I'm talking about, like, attitude-wise, like, maybe his ego's gotten a little bigger lately?
Well, now that you mention it...
Dear Mom, I haven't really had time to write. All these travels,
I mean, there was Hawaii and Fiji and Australia and France, and who's got time to work? Although I do have to get on a plane to go do this keynote. They're going to give me about $20,000 for 60 minutes, so I guess I can deal with that. Are you getting all this? Andrew, you getting all this?
Definitely.
Where was I? Oh, yeah. Ow! What's the matter with you? Are you crazy? I can't type with these hands if you cut my fingers off.
No one wants to hear from you anyway.
You're doing a crappy job. You missed a spot.
Yeah, and have you seen the new Top One cover?
Yeah, what was Andrew thinking?
Well, Joel's the designer on this one.
What? Joel designed it?
He sure did.
Hey, Sarah Jane.
Hey, Joel. What's
I got that that email about the Top One report.
Oh, with the new proofs?
Yeah. I feel like it's missing something.
Well, we're not totally done with it. I mean, it's still got to get the titles and some of the designs.
Yeah, no, it's not really that.
Something else?
Yeah.
Is it not colorful enough?
It needs, how do I put this? It needs more Joel.
More Joel.
Yeah, more Joel. Look, I know a little bit about Photoshop, so I did the mock-up of what I thought. This is what people are really looking for when they get the Top One reports. Just more of me.
Well, it certainly has more Joel.
That explains that, I guess. Man. But did you hear about the thing that happened in the studio the other day?
I know. I don't need a script. You do this. All right. Okay, you ready?
Yep. Okay. Action.
Hey, this is Joel Comm. I'm really glad. What are you doing? What is this?
They're giant
Cheetos. Giant freaking Cheetos. Look, take your 59-cent bag of Cheetos and put them away because we're in here. Look, I'm rolling tape. We've got the green screen up. My time is limited. I'm extremely busy. I've got a massage soon. I don't have time for this. You know, time is money.
I'm sorry.
This is what is your job? Do I come into your place and do your job? Do I come to your desk and move stuff around? Do I do that?
No.
And get giant Cheetos out when you're in the middle of something?
I'm sorry.
Amateurs. I've got amateurs. I'm surrounded by them, and I've had enough.
Yep. The old office still smells like giant Cheetos.
I'm the same.
Absolutely the same.
I'm the same guy. I've always been grounded as usual.
Yes.
Shall we play a game?
Oh, yeah, your favorite game.
I love this this book that I bought, Zamondo, otherwise known as The Outrageous Book of Bizarre Choices. And now, is it true that we have not rehearsed this?
No, not at all.
No, it's not true?
No, we haven't rehearsed it at all.
Okay, so would you rather eat someone's tumor right after it's been extracted?
Not a tumor.
Let me finish. Would you rather eat someone's tumor right after it's been extracted by surgery or chew and swallow someone's eyeballs?
I'll go with the eyeballs because I've seen Bear Grylls do it.
Because you've seen what?
Bear Grylls, Man vs. Wild. I've seen him eat eyeballs.
Oh, wow.
Besides, the tumor might not be good for you.
It pays to know your tumors before deciding. For example, the largest tumor ever was an ovarian cyst weighing 328 pounds taken from a woman in Texas in 1905. By the way, she made a full recovery. All right, one more.
Can I get two more?
All right. Would you rather have a sleepwalking problem that causes you to wander the streets at night or causes you to get up at night and pee all over your furniture?
Could I get paid to walk the streets at night?
I don't think so. That's Dan Nickerson, male gigolo.
Now I know why people have plastic on furniture.
We had that. We had that. My grandmother had this big old double wide chair with the, what do they call the
double wide chair?
No, the really thick plastic that they would put over it.
I don't know what they called it, but
It would just wipe clean.
Nice.
Answer the question.
I would have to go with peeing on my furniture because at least then I could put on some Depends or something and protect myself. Walking on the street might be a little more dangerous. It depends.
Watch this. You got anything else?
No.
That's it.
That's
hey, we made it through the first show. Be sure to follow us on Twitter. I'm at Joel Comm.
At Dan Nickerson.
And the hashtag for the show is the pound sign, Joel Comm. Let others know about it. Tell them to tune in to thejoelcommshow.com. We'll see you next time. Do good stuff.